Let's go.
I have a bone pick with you from iFilm. One time I went on to iFilm, and it's gone now. I don't know how it went away.
The bone?
What?
You said the bone. No, you have the bone to pick, but what's the bone?
Yes, here's the bone. I went on to iFilm to, like, see, you know, something, because I go on iFilm quite a bit. I like it. And it put something in my system tray without asking me or without, you know, giving a dialogue pop. And that's very seedy. It's very underhanded when internet people, you know, when websites do that. And not to make matters worse, there was no way to uninstall it. There was no way to disable it. It just, like, I think it was there on a timer and then, like, just kind of went away after a while. It was extremely annoying.
Well, Trevor, a lot of times in the case of free porn.
Right.
Which is obviously what you were surfing on iFilm, because there's some questionable mature content up there.
Yes.
What are you doing in these corners of this website?
I mean, I find, well, as pertaining to your question, I find that porn, on a socioeconomic, anthropological level, you can learn on a, like, through piecing, taking it apart symbolically and looking at its, you know, underlying currents a lot about any given society.
So you're past the smut.
Also, I find it helps me to masturbate.
Nice. Speaking of which, Kevin Smith, as your heralded director, takes your young adolescent character through some very, very rough things.
Sure, yeah. You could almost call this a coming-of-age experience.
Exactly.
No pun intended.
No, but now, with Kevin Smith's dialogue, how much of a soil sample did he go for? Did you get it all on the screen, or did you have to pull back some?
There were a couple of things. Most of it got on the screen, which is amazing, because a lot of it is quite dirty. Like, this is a film that, despite the fact that there's no nudity, there's no violence, there's nothing, like, explicitly shown, we were everyone, and, like, even the pragmatic producer people, like, not just Kevin, even the Weinstein Company, like, was preparing. Nobody thought, like, they were like, no way does this movie get an R rating. No way. Like, and it's all because of the dialogue. So it's like, it's amazing that we got all that stuff on.
Dialogue and, like this, your character saying, now, did Kevin write this line? I have a huge boner right now.
Yeah.
No, is that your line or is that Kevin's
line? No, that's Kevin's line. You know, I think they were like, Kevin's not, here's the deal about, like, Kevin Smith films. I don't mean to imply that he's, like, rigid at all with his style, because if you think that you have a better idea, he's totally open to it. And
sure.
Like, so I'm sure there were a few lines that, like, I, you know, may have come up with or was inspired by something that was already written or, you know, whatever, we collaborated on, figured out together, what have you. But for the most part, the script was, like, was born ready. You know what I mean? Like, the way it was, like, was the funniest way that I could think of. So we just did it that way.
Was there any shotgunning of beers at the Days Inn?
Shotgunning of beers?
Beer bongs. Whatever. What have you.
There was a lot of partying done at
the Days
Inn.
Take me back. I mean, I'm an outsider looking in, and I know you guys were a tribe.
The Days Inn was this was an amazing experience. You had, we filmed basically the entire movie on this one location, mm-hmm. right? And which was awesome. And literally, and we were also in Buena Park, California, which is, although it was close to me, I live in Long Beach, it's pretty far away from everybody else. And so, literally, here's the place that we were shooting, which was this, like, abandoned Burger King that we, like, retrofitted. I say we, like, I was there with a hammer.
Movies. We're talking about movies.
Right, the movies. And then literally next door was this Days Inn, which you can see in some of the shots of the film. And in lieu of getting dressing rooms or trailers or whatever, we just rented out basically the entire top floor of this motel. And we would just, like, we would wake up at 5, 6 in the morning, work for 10, 12 hours, go up to our rooms, like, cram into one room and play poker, drink beer, and smoke copious amounts of tobacco. There wasn't really a lot of, like, you know, drugs on the set. Just not a very druggy.
Best poker player?
Oh, Muse, by far. Muse and DK, his friend, are really great poker players. But Muse is amazing. Muse is good because Muse, he's really skilled, but he's also extremely lucky. Like, that guy, just fortune smiles on that dude.
What kind of pots are we talking about? What's the biggest?
You know, we would play $20-$40 buy-ins, you know, not that big. But, you know, when you play with 11 people, you can rack up quite a bit of dough. And I discovered the secret to earning money. Like, I'd never played poker before I started this movie, and we were playing poker basically every night. And I lost the first couple of times I did it, you know what I mean? Which was like, but then I started to figure out, like, I'm playing with drunk people. They're going to call anything. All I need to do is wait until I hit something and then bet big, and people will call me because they're too drunk. They're like, oh, I'm going to call this guy. And then we were only playing with dollar chips. So it's like, okay, 15 bucks, whatever. You know what I mean? And then so like I probably made $500-$600 throughout the course of this film. Just like
sweet.
Just on dollar chips.
Sweet. Hey, listen, iFilm editors, you got to keep the whole beginning of this interview in there because it's in its entirety. So come back to iFilm. We won't launch anything on you. We won't assault your personal computer.
Those fucking bastards.
Thanks, Trevor.
Thank you.